Okay, assalamualaikum and a very good morning to everybody. So welcome back from your mid-semester break. Okay, so this week we will continue on our lecture on estate agency practice. So this week we will look into the next topic. So previous week we have covered into topic 3, and this week we will look into the topic 4, which will be the types and sources of listing. And the content for this topic is we are going to look at the standard listing contracts, the open listing, the exclusive right to sell or lease, multiple listings, and also the sources of listings where you can get this type of listings. Okay, so at the end of the session, you are expected to be able to get an overall idea about listings and the types of listings, the listing contract, and also the sources of listing. Okay. So listing, for introduction, in real estate term, is a written engagement contract between a principal and an agent, authorizing the agent to perform the services for the principal, to handle the sale of real property, and to receive a fee or commission for services. So basically, listings is the most important aspect of an of the profession of estate agent. It's because this is where you will put most of your resources to, trying to help to promote, trying to sell, trying to lease or even rent out the properties. Meaning you have gathered. You have gathered all these properties together, and then this will be the properties that you will gain your commission from. Okay, so it is also a record of property for sale by an estate agent, not a broker. So in this case, it's estate agent who has been authorized by the owner to sell. Okay, so it's being given an example down there. So a bell applies Baker to find a buyer for his home by giving Baker a listing contract, whereby the means of appointment we have looked, whereby they need to fill in the appointment form to you, whether it's an exclusive agent or a sole agent or other types of agencies. So when they have signed the contract with you, then of course they can start to conduct the next stages to help in selling these properties. Okay, so when prospective buyers visit Baker, they will examine the listings in Baker's office. So in this case, you will not only have one particular property to be conducting business with. So of course, if you work as an estate agent, you must have several listings, or else if you are having just one listing, then is going to be a while for you to get an income. So of course, as an estate agent, we must always juggle the need between having a particular set amount of listing and the manpower and also resources for you to perform the transaction for them. So for an estate agent, usually at one time they will hold several listings. Might be having 10 or 15 listings at one time. So don't be as greedy. Don't take as much listing as possible. Although it's beneficial for you, but maybe you don't have the manpower or even the working time to cover all of the listing. So if you have 100 listings that are needed to be disposed in 1 month, so it's going to be very difficult and challenging for you. So you must know your own ability regarding how you are going to dispose of these properties. Okay, so might be 10 to 15 per month is quite okay. So for a well-experienced estate agent, so for a beginner estate agent, if you have 2 or 3 listings that you need to be disposing of in 1 month, then I think it's quite okay. But when eventually you get the experience, you are more knowledgeable in dealing with this transaction, then of course your skills will be upgraded. Okay, So, so in order for you to ascertain the listing, in order to ensure that it is a very good listing, you must conduct the viewing of the property. So this is a must for an agent to view the property, as because the reasons. So you need to see the condition of the house, whether the house is in a good state or a fair state or even a poor state. So you kena tengok lah dia punya rumah tu. Rumah tu ada kerosakan ke, ada kecacatan ke, rumah ni adakah ada punya tenant, adakah rumah ni ada telah pun di-abandonkan sekian lama, di-abandonkan lama ni you tahulah, you tengok macam-macam macam-macam benda yang akan berlaku pada rumah ataupun property tersebut lah. Abandon ni mungkin pintu hilang, tingkap hilang ataupun ada bekas-bekas penagihan dadah ke duduk dalam rumah tu, kita tak tahu kan. Sebab tu lah kena tengok, dan very important lah. So besides then, when you went towards the property, you must also check the surrounding area. You check the surrounding area, you see, first of all you see the nearby surrounding area of the property. Kalau you tengok rumah tu, depan tu you kena tengok lah, whether depan tu apa, ada padang ke, ada kolam kumbahan ke, ada tanah kuburan ke, ataupun depan tu ada KLCC ke. So you kena tahu, sebab benda-benda ni untuk valuer dia akan mempengaruhi nilai, dan untuk estate agent dia akan mempengaruhi marketability. Marketability meaning people willing to buy the property or not. Dia nak kita nak attract people to buy something, we must showcase what's the positive, and the negatives we also needed to disclose to them. The negative tu kita kena cakap kat dia lah. Kalau kita cakap semua positif je, bila dia datang property tu, dia tengok rumah saya depan sewage pond, depan kolam kumbahan, dia tak ada cakap pun, betul-betul depan dia, betul-betul jalan 5 langkah ke depan dah jumpa sewage pond. So you kena disclose juga to them. Okay, so you must know. Other than that, you have to go a little bit further than the property also. You kena tengok. Kalau depan rumah tu ada padang permainan, depan lagi daripada padang permainan tu, you tengok ada kedai-kedai, ada police station, ada school, ada shopping complexes and everything. So you must know particular area. Kalau you pilih Seri Skandar, you tengok dekat SIDEC tu kan, you kena tahulah ada D-Mall di depan, ada Tesco, ada Econsave, ada Billion, ada McDonald's. Itu pun salah satu penarik sekarang ni lah. Buat masa sekarang ni, most of the young buyers they really value this kind of facilities surrounding a property. Okay, so afterwards, of course you need to know and confirm the type of property. This is very important for an estate agent or for people from the real estate background like us. You kena tahu bezakan single story terrace house macam mana, double story terrace house, semi detached house, bungalow, ataupun detached house, apartment, condominium, and even flat, low cost apartment. So you kena tahu, you jangan salah beza. Semi detached house you katakan cluster house. You kena tahu semi detached is two houses conjoined together on the building. For cluster house is four houses clustered together. Four houses clustered together on the same building. So kena tahu jenis-jenis ni, jangan tersalah jenis property. So kita, yang itu kita cakap pasal residential. Kita kena tengok juga pasal commercial, industrial property, and also agriculture. Jenis-jenis tanah agriculture pun kena tahu. Tanah jenis pertanian, tanah jenis pertanian dusun, tanah jenis tanaman getah, tanaman sawit, tanaman nanas. You kan jumpa macam-macam jenis property di luar sana, dan you kena tahu jenis-jenis dia. So benda-benda ni mungkin di dalam classroom kita tak dapat tunjukkan semua, tapi by the time you go out there and you practice, then of course you will get more experience, and we will see much more the types of the property. Okay, and the next step is of course taking photograph. Taking photograph ni zaman dulu-dulu tu dia pakai Polaroid. Dia pakai Polaroid kan, ambil kan, ada 30 roll film dia boleh ambil gambar. You kena ambil gambar tu dengan cara apa, cara yang terbaik lah, sebab you nak jimat Polaroid, and then you nak take the best pictures. Tapi zaman sekarang ni, of course, kalau you ada digital camera, but most of the time tak payah digital camera pun, your smartphone is already advanced enough to take photograph. Okay, so you punya iPhone 12 tu kan, iPhone 12 tu you kena utilize lah all the features available in the iPhone 12. Dia punya HDR nya, dia punya landscape mode nya, dia punya filter dan sebagainya, you have to take. You have to take. So it's very convenient for us right now. Even our smartphone already have the the very good camera feature. So photograph is very important. You need to take the whole property punya photograph and then also the surrounding of the property. Yang you tengok tadi tu yang positif tu kan, you tengok school ke, you tengok commercial property nearby ke, CBD nearby ke, you take the photograph. Yeah, and also the inside of the property. So if people are interested into purchasing the property, then of course they are going to want to see the inside. Sebab kadang-kadang ni the external feature tu dia tak mencerminkan apa yang di dalam property tu. Luar nampak cantik, bersih kan, tapi di dalam punya ada banyak defect. Ada kebocoran, ada keretakan. Ada keretakan-keretakan di dinding dan sebagainya. So adalah amat penting lah, for you to take a very good quality photograph with a very high resolution for people to inspect, for people to inspect and make up their mind. Dia tengok dalam ni okey lah kan, tengok resolution dia tinggi kan, you ambil sampai 64 megapixel, you boleh zoom tengok tak ada crack pun, tak ada kotoran dan sebagainya. So it's very important lah, because as we know, a photo tells a thousand story. So sangat penting lah, kalau kita nak tengok apa-apa, nak beli barang sekalipun kan, nak beli telefon ke, nak beli PS5 ke, you mesti nak tengok gambar dia dulu, betul tak? Takkan you beli satu benda langsung tak tengok gambar kan. So it's very important for this. Okay, and then afterwards you need to estimate the reasonable selling price. So this one is recommended for you or even for the principal to appoint a valuer. To appoint a valuer to ascertain the proper market value for the property. Tapi kalau you tak ada valuer ataupun principal tu tak nak appoint valuer, you sebagai estate agent you tak boleh buat valuation. Tapi you boleh estimate lah. You boleh estimate, you tengok transaction data by JPPH, you tengok beberapa property sekitar tu, you tengok banyak yang jual 500, 520, 530, 490, so you make your own estimation. Maybe this particular property is reasonable to be sold at RM500,000. You bukan buat valuation, you just estimate saja. Kalau disclaimer dia, kalau dia nakkan market value yang proper, the principal mesti kena buat valuation report with a registered valuer. So it's very important for you not to overstep the boundary. So ada boundary dia between registered estate agent and also registered valuer. So you tak boleh melakukan tugas-tugas seorang registered valuer, or else you can be taken action by the board of valuer. Okay, and then afterwards of course you need to make the recommendation. Recommendation tu based on the condition of the property lah. Kalau you tengok sesebuah property ataupun rumah tersebut, keadaan yang sangat berlalang di luar kan, ada banyak vegetation kat luar tu kan, mungkin you kena kata towards the principal, tuan tolonglah potong sikit lalang ni kan, macam mana orang nak beli rumah ni kalau lalang ni setinggi setinggi KL Tower ni kan, so orang pun boleh hilang dalam lalang ni kan. You kena bagi recommendation macam mana cara untuk bagi property tersebut in a condition that is presentable. And for the potential buyer, you need also to make recommendation how to improve the property. Kalau you present to them with the property, you ada beberapa defect, ada kecacatan dan celah lah, dan you dah disclose towards the potential buyer, you kata lah kepada potential buyer tu, encik kalau encik beli property ni, mungkin encik kena cat balik, mungkin encik kena buat repair dekat bumbung ni sebab ada leaking sikit, mungkin encik kena tukar dia punya wallpaper sebab wallpaper dia ada terkopek, tercabut dan sebagainya. Kalau you tak boleh buat benda-benda tu, you make recommendation for them. Tapi kalau benda-benda kecil ni Biasanya sebagai agent ni kita tolong lah, kita tolong sebab kita nak jual, kita nak jual, kita nak present the property as good as possible. Kalau benda-benda kecil sakat mungkin sapu-sapu ataupun you nak mop lantai dia, nak bagi bersih sikit dan sebagainya, mungkin kita boleh buat sendirilah. Tapi kalau benda-benda yang terlalu besar sampai nak kena repair bumbung, nak kena repair dinding, tu mungkin potential buyer kena keluarkan cost ataupun principal yang kena keluarkan cost dahulu. Okay, clients confident and the agent will be increased. Ini dia reason kenapa penting untuk kita buat benda-benda ini, sebab this is actually based on services that we give. So when people see that our services is professional, when people see that we as an estate agent is knowledgeable, kita dah tahu benda-benda ni dan sebagainya, kita pun dah biasa buat dan sebagainya, kita pun ada knowledge, kita ada knowledge dalam the real estate. Of course, lagilah you all ni graduan-graduan real estate, estate management. So of course you will have the knowledge in marketing, you will have the knowledge in building, you will have the knowledge in valuation. So kita meyakinkan, meyakinkan klien kita, either the principal or even the potential buyer. So they will be more confident in us. Okay. And lastly is know and familiar with the product he or she is selling. Okay. So types of listing contracts provided in MIAS. So the contract is often referred to as listing agreement. So this is whereby you have obtained, you have obtained the signature from the principal or even from the potential seller or even buyer. So MIAS provide the format for agents to use. So this kind of form is available in MIAS. So it's part two, is very important for you to get a copy of MIAS. So among the format or forms that you can use is the authorization to secure property for acquisition, authorization to secure property for rent, exclusive authorization to let, general authorization to let, general authorization to sell, and also the exclusive authorization to sell. So dia ada jenis-jenis ataupun berapa perbezaan di situ lah. Authorization exclusive, tak exclusive, secara umum dan sebagainya. Kita tengok kat sini bukan saja untuk menjual, tapi untuk membeli, untuk memajak dan juga untuk menyewa. Sebab ini adalah skop-skop bidang tugas kita. Jangan kata ejen ni berfungsi untuk menjual property saja. Itu memang kita punya bread and butter. Itu memang kita punya tugas dan bidang utama. Tapi perkara-perkara lain pun kita boleh lakukan, seperti yang tertakluk di bawah Malaysian Estate Agency Standard dan juga VAEA 1981. So standard listing contract kita kena tengok jugalah, kita kena tengok the beginning and termination date. So kalau principal to appoint you, dia nak appoint you berapa lama, adakah dia nak appoint you untuk sebulan, dua bulan, tiga bulan ataupun enam bulan. So usually dalam form tu, dalam real world practice, biasanya kita akan cuba dapatkan time limit yang paling lama lah, which usually is about 6 months time, 6 bulan masa. So kita at least kita ada apa orang kata, tak perlu risau lah dari segi situ. Tak adalah tiba-tiba hari ni appoint, esok dah terminate. Oh, you tak berjaya jual hari ni kata kan. You pun kalau you jadi estate agent pun, you pun tak maulah ambil kan. Appoint satu hari 24 jam je nak jual. Kalau you nak ambil juga, ambil lah kalau you rasa boleh jual 24 jam kan. Tapi masa ni penting lah, because it provides a deadline for you and also the deadline for the principal. Dalam masa 6 bulan ni tiba-tiba dia kata dia nak berubah fikiran kan. You kata kat dia, tak boleh cik, cik dah sign contract 6 bulan. So kalau nak tunggu berubah fikiran tu, tunggu sehingga 6 bulan. Kalau property ni tak berjaya dijual dan sebagainya, barulah kita akan terminatekan kontrak ini. Barulah boleh expire kontrak tersebut. Kalau tidak, kalau tidak encik tak boleh buat apa-apa lah, sebab encik dah sign kontrak dengan kita. So it's very important for you lah. Okay, so and also the list price at which the property will be offered for sale, dah kena determine kat situ. Tak boleh berubah-ubah sangat. Principal ni kejap-kejap nak RM500,000, kejap-kejap nak RM450,000, kejap-kejap nak RM600,000. You pun pening nak ikut dia. Kejap nak macam ni, you kena teman macam-macam pula, iklan you dekat mudah.my, dekat iProperty, dekat banner you dan sebagainya, you kena buat amendment banyak-banyak. So you kena stick, you kena cakap kat dia kalau nak 500, 500. Kalau nak lebih rendah daripada tu, mungkin kita buat, boleh buat negotiation, negotiation with the potential buyer. Okay, so the amount of compensation offered to the agent, whether it is in the form of a flat fee or percentage of the sales price. Ini adalah sebenarnya you punya commission lah. Kalau you berjaya jual, tak berjaya jual, you punya disbursement. Maksudnya disbursement tu contoh macam you punya cost lah. Cost you nak pergi daripada Perak, tiba-tiba ada potential buyer nak jumpa di Kelantan, so you kena keluarkan duit minyak dan duit tol dan sebagainya. So ini adalah salah satu contoh lah, perkara di mana you boleh dapatkan semula compensation, disbursement dan juga you punya fee lah. Of course it's very important. Bila dah sign contract ni, contohnya principal dah appoint you on the exclusive agent, tiba-tiba dia jual sendiri dan sebagainya, dia tak nak bayar you compensation, then you boleh bawa ke mahkamah. Dia kata you dah sign for exclusive agent tapi you kena bayar kat si, bayar kat saya, tapi you tak nak bayar, dan saya bawa pergi mahkamah. Dan mahkamah of course lah, dia akan tengok validity of the contract, then of course they can instruct the principal to pay the compensation. Okay, the term and condition under the which agent agent's fee shall be paid by the seller. Ini dalam term and condition ni usually you dah specify lah. Saya tak nak dalam bentuk dalam bentuk shilling, ataupun dalam bentuk orang kata installment, you bayar saya punya commission 30 tahun, saya tak nak macam tu lah. So usually you kena, dah kena specify earlier lah, you give the principal the type of payment that he or she can be made. Kalau you nak terima e-wallet ke, you nak terima Shopee Pay ke, that is ultimately up to you. Tapi biasanya kita, untuk transaksi ni kita terima, kita terima either cash, bank in ataupun check lah. So apa-apa cara yang, apa-apa cara lah sebenarnya, selagi principal tersebut bayar kepada awak, bayar kepada awak, so kita dapat kita punya income. Okay, so authorizes the agent to cooperate with other agent as sub agent or buyer agent and detail the compensation to be offered to those agent in the event they procure a buyer. So ni kalau you cooperate, kalau you nak cooperate with other agent, you kena beritahu lah you punya principal. Contohnya ada agent tu memang dia ada buyer, you memang ada seller, you pun ada property yang nak dia nak, and then you boleh mungkin kongsi lah commission fee tu 50-50, ataupun you ambil sedikit ataupun lebih lagi. That is up to you, but you need to have the permission from the principal. So number 6 is authorizes the agent to reveal or not to reveal the existence of offers previously received. Ini pun salah satu kebenaran yang you kena dapatkan jugalah. Kalau property itu ada beberapa offer, tapi principal kata jangan bagi tahu, jangan bagi tahu offer ni berapa, you just beritahu kat dia ada offer tapi you jangan beritahu berapa banyak offer dia. Biarkan potential buyer yang lain tu tanya-tanya kan, cukup ke aku offer RM500,000 kan, dan tahu orang lain tu offer RM600,000, padahal orang lain tu offer RM450,000 saja, dia offer dah RM500,000, tapi you tak cakap, you dah cakap ada potential buyer. So bila mana you buat macam gitu, you tak disclose dia potential buyer yang nak offer RM500,000 tu, dia akan rasa pressure lah, dia akan rasa pressure untuk menyelesaikan transaksi tersebut secepat mungkin, sebab dia tak nak property tersebut jatuh di tangan orang lain. Okay, so in addition, terms may be include is authorization to the agent to post a sign, advertise property, put lock box on the door, obligation to advise condition of property, and also regulation and law which may affect the sale. So ini penting lah, sebab bila you handle the property, you are not the owner of the property, you just the agent. So bila you sebagai agent ni, you kena dapatkan segala kebenaran daripada you punya principal. Jangan you memandai-mandai masuk, memecahkan pintu, you ambil gambar sesuka hati dan sebagainya. Sebab it's very sensitive, because that is a property belonging to another person. So of course lah, kalau kita punya harta kan, orang buat sesuka hati kan, memanglah saya lantik you agent kan. Tapi kenapa you suka-suka hati masuk, saya punya property pecahkan itu, pecahkan ini, eh, buat renovation, buat bumbung tiba-tiba, eh, saya tak ada suruh you buat benda-benda macam tu pun you buat sesuka hati. Ha, saya pun boleh ambil tindakan kat awak lah. Ha, walaupun saya nanti awak agent, awak buat sesuka hati tanpa izin saya, ha, you pun boleh kena. Okay? Dan sebagainya, sebagai agent juga you kena advise regulation and law. Ha, regulation and law ni sebenarnya, you must remember, for property is under state. Ha? For property is under state because land is state matter. Ha, so, keadaan-keadaan undang-undang adalah berbeza-beza. Ha? Di wilayah Persekutuan Kuala Lumpur berbeza dengan di Perak dan juga di Kelantan. Ha? Contohnya di Kelantan. Ha? Untuk membeli property di Kelantan, tak semua orang boleh membeli Kelantan kecuali ikut enactment undang-undang tubuh kerajaan negeri Kelantan. Ha? Mestilah kena orang yang dilahirkan di Kelantan dan sebagainya. Ha? So, you kena tengok dan you kena tahu. Undang-undang setiap negeri adalah berbeza-beza. Ha? Adakah property tersebut Bumi Putra punya kota? Ha? Kalau dah Bumi Putra punya kota, tak boleh jual kepada non-bumi. Ha? Kalau property tersebut Malay Reserve Land, lagilah, of course, you boleh jual kepada Malay sahaja. Ha? Dan you tak boleh jual. Tiba-tiba ada potential buyer, developer, Chinese company, dan of course, you cannot go on with the transaction. Kalau you go on juga, you akan buang masa lah. Sebab bila you pergi ke pejabat tanah daerah ataupun pejabat tanah galian, then of course the transaction cannot proceed. It's because the law and regulation already state that this person cannot purchase the Malay Reserve Land. So it's very important for you to know the law and regulation of a particular state in Malaysia. Sabah, Sarawak, Perlis, Kelantan dan sebagainya. So, this is the standard listing contract. You boleh tengok contohnya di sini ataupun you boleh tengok di dalam Malaysian Estate Agency Standard. So, ada beberapa perkara lah. Penting lah. Nombor IC, nama penuh, nama penuh dan nombor IC. Appointment daripada bila sampai bila, nak jual berapa. Dan dia punya disclaimer di sini lah. Compensation dia. Dia punya term and condition, we have declared, we have not appointed any other estate agency, and then you punya you punya signature dan juga principal punya signature. It's very important, sebab signature ni shows that we have agreed to enter into this contract. So it's very important lah. Sebab tu kita ni kalau nak sign apa-apa borang, memanglah kalau orang tu bagi borang kan, contohnya kita nak beli SIM card kan, kita nak beli kan, memang dia bagi kita borang senang. You sign sini, dia tunjuk tu kan. Sebenarnya kalau dalam apa-apa borang sekalipun, you kena baca betul-betul term and condition dia. You kena baca dan you kena tahulah apa sebenarnya you sign ni. Entah-entah you sign untuk serahkan segala harta pusaka you dan sebagainya, you tak tahu, tapi you main sign saja. So it's very important for us to read the term and condition. Memanglah kadang-kadang tu kan, kalau apa-apa perkara kan, kita download app dan sebagainya kan, siapa nak baca term and condition sampai 500 page kan. Tapi tu kalau benda kecil-kecil tu mungkin lah you boleh pandang sekilas lalu, at least pandang sekilas lalu lah. Tapi kalau benda-benda yang besar-besar, ada borang yang bertulis dan sebagainya, yang physical copy pula tu, you kena tengok lah betul-betul lah. Sebab ini menjaga kepentingan kita, menjaga kepentingan prinsipal juga. Lebih kepada menjaga kepentingan kita lah sebagai seorang manusia sebenarnya. Bukan saja agent kan, bukan saja agent yang kena baca betul-betul, semua orang kena baca sebenarnya. Okay. So, term and listing contract, ni macam kita tengok tadi lah, the expenses, the time and effort of an estate agent, the listing time period, berapa lama you nak being appointed. Okay, if the property not sold, the seller may decide to release the property, maybe with a different listing price. So, listing contract have beginning and expiration date, typically 30 days to 60 days, very seldom extend to 90 days except for special cases. Tapi biasanya kita cuba dapatkan yang paling panjang lah. Janganlah panjang sangat sampai berpuluh-puluh tahun kan. Macam tu, you tak buat apa-apa pun tak ada masalah. Biasanya kita tak nak lah terlalu lama. Okay. So listing price also include listing price for the property. Seller must pay fee or commission at the final price. Kalau you kata RM500,000, 3% of your commission, you patutnya boleh dapat 3% tu RM200,000, 3 kali 100 around RM15,000, tapi tiba-tiba you jual RM400,000, then of course the commission is going to be lower than that. You jangan masih insist juga nakkan RM15,000 tersebut. So you kena take you kena take the lower price of commission of about RM12,000, RM400,000, sebab you tak jual RM500, you jual RM400. Okay, setting the price, owners normally tend to overestimate the value of the property. Ini satu perkara yang saya tengok dalam experience saya, memang majority lah. Dia biasa akan overestimate. Tak tahulah mananya owner ataupun principal yang dapat dia punya value, kan. Dia main plug from the air je, kan. Dia rasa, oh, saya beli property ni 5 tahun dulu RM300,000. Saya rasa boleh jual RM600,000 lah. Saya beli dulu 2015 RM300,000. Saya rasa dalam 5 tahun ni dah double lah ni. Dah double ni. Biasalah manusia, kan. Dia tak ada manusia punya sikap, kan. Dia overestimate lah. Kita sayang satu benda, kan. Oh, telefon aku ni bagus ni, mahal ni, kan. Man, kita sayang, kan, sebab ada sentimental value dan sebagainya. Kita estimate value, kalau orang tanya estimate value berapa? RM5,000. Tapi you bawa kat kedai, ataupun you bawa pergi pajak, dia tengok, you punya telefon ni I will give you RM1,000. Itu market value dia. You kata, mana boleh, ini RM5,000 tau. Saya guna telefon saya ni untuk ODL dan sebagainya. It's very valuable to me. So other people that might not see the same value as you. So untuk property is the same lah. Daripada RM300 jadi RM600,000. Padahal bila buat valuation report, bila register valuer, dia tengok property dia cuma naik jadi RM350,000 saja, bukannya RM600,000. So you pun kena advice lah, you punya principal. I think you punya property ni cannot sell at RM600,000. That is a very overestimation yang melampau-lampau. Tak tahulah kalau ada orang in their reasonable mind untuk beli property ni atau tidak. You kena tahu. Sebabnya, kalau you sell property that is usually over than the above market value, then it will have problem when the potential buyer wants to submit for their housing loan. Housing loan ni, you pergi bank, bank juga akan check dengan registered value. Bank akan buat valuation report. It's the same thing. So of course, even though registered valuer ni dia value ada perbezaan di antara mereka, tapi sebenarnya perbezaan tu tidaklah banyak mana. Tak adalah sampai beza RM200,000-RM300,000. Sebabnya dia orang akan guna transaction data yang sama daripada JPPH. So mungkin dia beza tu mungkin dalam RM10,000-RM20,000-RM30,000 paling besar pun. Tak adalah sampai RM100,000 macam you punya principal estimate. So you kena tahu, sebabnya kalau you tak berjaya jual, of course you tak akan dapat you punya commission. So you buang masa, penat-penat je, kan. Penat-penat je pergi tampal banner sana sini, post kat mudah, kena bayar RM50 sebulan dan sebagainya. Tiba-tiba you tak boleh dapat pun sebab tak boleh nak jual. So buang masa, you kena tahu lah. Okay, so don't let the seller set the price. So you need to advise on reasonable price. So the agent must know more about the property price, and you need to do the proper property survey. Sebab tu dari pentingnya you kena ada networking. You kena ada networking lah. You kena ada kenal banker, you kena ada kenal registered valuer dan sebagainya. Kalau you ni seorang registered valuer yang buat kerja estate agency, lagilah bagus. You boleh buat sendiri valuation. Tapi kalau you adalah seorang registered estate agent sahaja, so it's much better than that you have this networking. So it's because kalau you engage with registered valuer, then of course registered valuer ni dia pun boleh dapatkan case daripada you. Dia boleh dapat case dan dia pun boleh dapat fee dia melalui valuation report. So win-win situation lah, okay. So support advice with comparison fact, figure and writing report and also evidences or data. So usually kita pakai data JPPH lah. Transaction data daripada JPPH, daripada NAPI. Kalau tak ada data daripada NAPI ataupun JPPH tersebut, then you pakailah data-data yang you boleh dapat daripada report-report ataupun daripada nama web-nama web. Okay. So if owner disagree, you need to suggest any recommendation to the owner. So price reduction can be suggested if market is not so good, if property cannot be sold after certain time. Kalau you check market value dia RM350,000, then principal cuba menjual RM380,000. Dia dah tahu dan dia cuba naikkan sikit lah. Tapi masih tidak berjaya juga untuk dijual. Dan of course, after certain time, you boleh suggest kepada dia, cik, property ni dah 3 bulan kita cuba jual. Saya dah buat macam-macam di luar tu. Saya dah post dekat property, saya dah post dekat laman web, social media dan sebagainya, tapi tak berjaya juga tuan. Sebab ni property market is very sluggish right now. Sebab orang lebih concern, like right now what is happening lah, orang lebih concern nak beli beras je, nak beli beras kan. Orang lebih concern bukan nak membeli investment dan sebagainya. So you mungkin boleh kurangkan lah, mungkin you boleh jual lower than 380 tadi, you jual lah 360 ataupun 355, boleh lah you dapat lebih sikit daripada market value. Sebab tu kena hati-hati juga kan, kena hati-hati ya. So kalau you claim under market value tapi people check that is the property is not under market value, you kata 380 under market value tapi bila orang check is under 350, dia bawah daripada RM350,000 dia punya market value tapi you claim tinggi, sebenarnya you pun boleh kena ambil tindakan with bought value, sebab you overclaim. So sebab you nak kata nak cerita best lah kan, nak cerita sedap je kan, you pun overclaim kata ini under market value sebagainya. So hati-hati, okay. So term in listing contract, payment or commission of fee. So for you to obtain the commission, so of course paling penting tu purchase contract tersebut mestilah berjaya. Mestilah berjaya tu it means that both parties sign, you punya principal sign, you punya potential buyer pun dah sign, sign dokumen contract yang disediakan oleh seorang peguam, dan ada saksi dan sebagainya lah. Maknanya kontrak tersebut tu dah valid dan boleh dibawa ke mahkamah. Selepas tu finding satisfactory buyer who is ready willing able to pay the full listing price. Ini sebenarnya sebelum lah. So if the seller refuse to sell, then typically consider that the real estate agent must has done his job and the seller must still pay the commission. Tiba-tiba kata tak nak jual pula dalam tempoh kontrak tersebut. Kontrak you ambil 6 bulan jadi exclusive agent, tiba-tiba dalam bulan yang kedua dia tak nak jual. Saya rasa tak nak jual lah, saya sayang pula saya punya rumah ni. You tak kira, you paksa dia sama ada jual juga ataupun you bayar saya ganti rugi commission 3%. I don't care because we have the contract. We have the contract, saya boleh bawa you pergi mahkamah. Okay, so unless closing is a condition of the listing contract, itu kalau ada term condition tu dia beritahu dalam borang tersebut, you kena settlekan transaksi juga. Kalau tak berjaya settle, tak boleh dapat commission. Sebab itulah penting untuk you tengok the type of contract between you and the principal. So which will help to benefit both of you. Janganlah benefit kepada you saja melampau-lampau, ataupun benefit kepada principal saja. You ni macam tak ada kepentingan langsung, macam melukut di tepi gantang saja kan, mengharapkan tu je kan. So you kena win-win situation, okay. Other than that, to cooperate with other agent, sub agent or buyer agent, detailed compensation to be offered, agent to refill if have any other offer we receive formally. Ni kita dah tengok tadi lah, okay. So kita nak tengok juga the types of listing contract, but I think let me check. But I think we have covered half of the topic four. For the next one, type of listing contract, exclusive, general, open listing, multiple listing, or net listing, I think we will go through in next week. Okay, so with that, I will conclude the lecture today. So if you have any questions, then you can contact me through WhatsApp or email or what other kind of telecommunications, yeah, and then I will get back to you as soon as possible. Okay, so with that, I end the lecture with wabillahi taufiq wa hidayah. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.